So Stranger Things is, it was in the 80s. It was perfect for me to watch, and it got me a long time actually to watch it. But the other streaming original that I freaking loved to death last year, and season 2 is coming out on the 20th of this month. It's Voltron Legendary Defender. The Voltron reboot from DreamWorks Animation with the animation team behind Avatar: Last Airbender and Legend of Korra. The animation is beautiful. The people behind who did Avatar: Last Airbender, just their animation style is just perfect for Voltron. There's a mix between 2D and 3D animation. The 3D animation's more for the Voltron and the lions, the robotic lions. Oh my God, it's so good. But it's a reboot of a 80s animated show, and it does a good reboot, and it gives you the characters. There's plenty of great characters in the show. The animation, like I said, is amazing, and I can't wait for season 2 coming out this month. So if you like giant robots and space, Voltron's for you.
Yeah, I think I saw the. They had a premiere movie for that,
Yeah, that was
right?
yeah, it was a full-length like pilot movie. Yeah, and then
Yeah, I.
the rest of the episodes are like 22 minutes long, so like half hour shows.
I believe I gave the pilot movie a watch, but I can't really say that I remember anything distinctive about it.
Yeah, it's
I can yeah I'd finger the Legend of Korra people in terms of animation. Yeah. yeah, you see what I did there?
Yeah, I see what you did.
But in terms, yeah, I'm gonna have to go. I would have to go with Stranger Things, but I also wanted for my perfect streaming original. But because I know that there's so many millions of things, and I think Morgan, that's why I was pointing at him earlier. I don't know if I don't know if that translated it in our screens here,
That was perfect,
but
actually. Yeah, point that way. That's where Morgan is. Yeah, that's perfect.
okay, over here.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm actually below you two from the way I'm looking at it. I'm literally
Yeah.
James here, Mike here. I'm just right
I
here.
know. Yeah.
All right, this guy then.
Nope,
This
nope,
guy,
nope,
let him.
nope, nope. For the recording, he's to your l left.
To my
Oh, hi.
left.
Yeah.
Hi.
There
Oh, hey, there you are.
you go.
So,
Perfect.
can't wait to meet you this summer.
No,
Okay.
neither can I.
But
I'm
yeah, I
straight as
just want.
foot.
There we
Down
go.
to there.
And the yeah, I figure that Morgan would actually probably be the better one to discuss Stranger Things, but or at least start off that conversation. That's why I'm gonna let him have the honor. I just want to give a few other mentions here because there were a lot of series. There were a lot of series that premiered that I like. I would the one series that premiered this year that I'm going to be watching more of is Skylanders Academy, which if you know me, there's you're gonna know that I like to do silly Saturday morning kids rate stuff whenever I get the chance, and that is very much what Skylanders Academy is, taking the recipe of the game, taking Spyro the Dragon and making a show with that character. I would be sold on the fact that they made a purple dragon the central character for anything. But they got an amazing cast for this. They have SNL's Norm Macdonald. They got Bobcat Goldthwait, and they got I think it's Jason Lee playing Spyro. No,
Yes.
yeah, Ashley Tisdale playing the thief elf, and they've got so many other names. Susan Sarandon's in there.
You also forgot Richard Horvitz is one of the villains.
Oh yeah,
he was a Daggett from Angry Beavers.
Yes, he was the one who you pointed out when we watched it together. Yeah, this fits in with other shows that I watched, like I like shows like the Adventures of Puss in Boots that they have on Netflix. So this is something that sort of fell in pretty well with me, and especially as a gamer, the plot and the formulas, it all blends together in a sense that's both episodic and fluid throughout every episode. So they have things set up now for season two. It's getting a season two, and I look forward to it.
Cool.
So let's talk about Stranger Things.
This was pretty unexpected. This was not unexpected, actually. I knew it was going to get this spot. And if it wasn't for this one, it probably would have been something like Pee-wee's Big Holiday.
Oh,
but the
yeah.
problem with yeah, the problem with Big Holiday is that it tries to be the next Big Adventure, and it falls short because of how loose the story is. Not saying it's not a bad movie.
No.
But it's something that kind of come and gone. It was like, oh, cool, Pee-wee movie, and then people saw it, and it was just brushed under the rug. It was like, this was supposed to lead to, like, more Pee-wee movies or adventures, or at least Paul Reumans is doing something. He still has the spirit. But I can kind of see why that movie plays itself a little too safe in spots. I mean, there's still some really invented stuff, like the opening sequence where he goes around town, he unleashes like a big Rube Goldberg machine, in a sense, when he's getting ready. That was kind of neat. There's a bit with the snake farm that goes on a little too long, but it's kind of interesting. The scene where he, like, entertains the Amish is pretty cool, and it's actually pretty hilarious. But other than that, I just wish that movie had a little more punch. But Stranger Things, it hit a whole lot of sweet spots. It's like stuffing 1980 Steven Spielberg, Stephen King, John Carpenter, and a shot of Joe Dante into a blender and served on the side with a waffle garnishing it.
Oh, I want to point out something else.
Oh, yeah, and John Hughes, too.
I want to point out this the Pete's Dragon reboot was supposed to take place in the 80s.
Yes. Oh
but
my god.
Did you get any sense of 80s in that?
I live tweeted the movie and I complained about the music so much because it had no sense of the 80s whatsoever. I was like, where's my 80s soundtrack music? You gave me this country twang bullshit in the Pete's Dragon movie, but yeah. No. So, yes, that's
because all of the 80s all of the 80s-ness was sucked up by Stranger Things.
Yes, I agree. Yes, because the music. I love the music in Stranger Things. That soundtrack was that's my jam.
It had a really good use of heroes in episode 3 or 4, I think. That got me hooked by the first episode because so much goes on, and it feels like the best of the 80s is like literally
yes.
scrapbooked together.
Yes.
You have the kids doing the Goonies. One of them goes missing. There's a girl with telepathic powers and stuff. There's these scientists, this police chief that's trying to get in this whole thing, crazy Winona Ryder who's trying to figure out where her son is, and there's like these things where he communicates with the lights and stuff, and you don't know if she's like batshit insane or not.
Oh, that was brilliant. Like,
I loved her. I thought that was a great comeback. She was so brilliant.
Oh, yeah, she... Like, I'm going
to
say that...
Speak to me, son, speak to me!
That is one of her the best performances of her career. Yeah, she's done with the 80s, she's done with the 90s. It's great to see that her career recovered from that whole clothing swap thing. I think killed off her career for a long time, but I really feel like she's that's something that's pretty much forgotten anyway. So
yeah.
You're looking at her now as she's I'm rooting for her.
And what I like too is how everything just perfectly clicks together, and that last episode, it's left on such an open hook, where even if they weren't commissioned for a season two, I still would have been okay with it. I really would have.
Mm-hmm.
We'll let the fan fiction write itself there.
But seeing that they're going to do a season two, I'm curious to see where it's going to go.
Mm-hmm.
Even Netflix said it's unwise to do a second season. It's smart, it's clever, it's funny when it needs to be. There's so many twists and turns. You are just so sucked in by the mystery behind this sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I was watching this with my mother. When I was watching a second time around, I had my mother get involved. First episode, she was like, I don't know if I should keep watching. This is kind of weird. Second episode, better. Third episode, hooked.
Mm-hmm.
And even then... and when she got to, like, the very last episode, I was like, there's going to be a season two. Ooh, good! But no, it's very well written. The only nitpick I do have is the John Hughes storyline with the daughter character. I forgot her name. But apparently she was that thing where there's the creepy kid taking pictures and everything, and the nice looking Tom Cruise like guy.
Oh,
it doesn't
okay.
know which of the two to fall for, but the Tom Cruise guy is her boyfriend and stuff, and they have a riff. That was a little out of place, especially when you have science fiction, detective, noir, mystery, fantasy. The fact it's doing Halloween 3, but better. It
yeah.
is. Really think about it.
Yeah, they have all those twists, but they try to add in that 80s like romantic subplot in there for the girls.
Let me tell you, of all the summer movies I've seen, if this was a movie, this would be immediately best of the year. But because it's a Netflix series, I can't have that happen.
Yeah, like, don't get me wrong, Stranger Things is amazing. I didn't put it in the category because it took me forever to get around to watching, because it came out when I was busy at the most, and it just took me a while to sit through it, and, I mean, the concepts are there, the 80s, it's oozing with 80s, I love the 80s, the music was great, like I said, and the...
80s.
Eleven was the best part of it. Like, she was amazing, you know? She's a badass, you don't... But her, like, backstory, too, was just interesting enough, and how she's doing
great
everything.
Backstory.
It was great.
Hey, Morgan, do you think that she should play young Princess Leia in the upcoming Star Wars films?
That is an interesting question. I always thought it was sort of an X-Men mutant, but that could work, too.
Okay. It was something that was brought up.
Yeah, I know, I seen it too. I was like, I think because her name is Millie Bobby Brown, I believe, and she's a great actress. She's a young and coming actress. I think with Stranger Things as being the start of it, she might have great stuff in the future with more movies and TV stuff. So,
yeah.
But I don't know, the creatures, like, it, wow, the creatures. The creatures in this thing. And then the upside down world.
They were pretty scary.
Wow. It just.
The introduction of the creatures, it was. It was kind of like. You know, she's talking to her son through the wall, and it's like. And you're just like, okay, is that her son or not? And. Whoosh!
Yeah.
That was a. It's a cliche moment a little bit, but it was kind of. You weren't prepared for it, were you?
Let me just say, in the last episode where the teenager characters try to kill the monster in the house, didn't it remind you a little bit like Nightmare on Elm Street in a sense?
Yeah. Kind of, sort of.
Because I thought that was a little clever, too.
I feel like this show is more or less... It's not totally 80s in terms of everything, but it's more like in terms of how it's shot and presented and displayed. Mm-hmm. It's more like a millennial look at the 80s
yeah.
tropes, you know.
Yeah, I like how one house It's just all E.T., like, where the kids are playing Dungeons and Dragons and stuff. And
Yeah.
then you have the Evil Dead house where there's poltergeists going on.
Yeah.
If this were any more 80s, you would have no CGI whatsoever.
Well,
Yeah.
here's the thing, they make it not like aesthetically look like the 80s. I mean, not like the footage or anything like that. They set it up to make it look like it's from the 80s, like with all the cars and the setting, not like modern technology. Yeah, there is CG. You can easily see the CG in this.
Oh, yeah.
It's easily tell, and that's kind of one of the downgrades. Like, really, you could have used practical effects. I mean, why use CG? I mean,
It's not so bad. It's not
it's
so bad. It's just what they're doing with it, I guess.
Should we quickly go through independent because I already said mine
Yeah, I was gonna
earlier.
say, I was gonna ask James what his independent was.
Okay. Oh, great Scott, we already mentioned one that had me talking earlier. Why not go with another independent film that I was in this year?
Oh, that one, which I
Oh,
didn't see yet.
me neither.
Yes, I
So.
wanted to.
The independent that I chose was I Am Not a Serial Killer, starring Max from Where the Wild Things Are versus Christopher Lloyd as the alien. It's no, he's not a Martian this time. Thank goodness.
Referring to that.
Referring to SH.
It's funnier if Matt was here. Because he'd be like, Morgan, don't! Morgan, don't!
So,
Morgan, don't! All right.
yeah, I'm not a serial killer. We have Max Records, the kid who played Max in Where the Wild Things Are, now sort of grown up a little bit more. He's a teenager playing. He's drawn a teenager with some rather sociopathic tendencies, triggers that his sociologist has brought up. Everyone's worried about him. He obsesses over serial killers. He even works in his mom's mortuary, because why wouldn't you? And yeah, he's noticing the string of murders, and he's just sort of because with his obsession of serial killers and his oncoming psychosis, he's starting to look into what might be causing these murders. And it's based off of a book, also, which I have not read. But while he's solving the mystery, he narrows it down to it must be old man Mr. Crowley, a character played by Christopher Lloyd. And the way that he figures this out, I'm not spoiling anything because they give it away halfway through the film, is he follows them out ice fishing, and Mr. Crowley is ice fishing with this other guy, and they take a chainsaw to the ice because it's wintertime. They cut it open, stick the rods in, and at one point Mr. Crowley starts leaning over and coughing really, really haphazardly, and the other guy is sort of unprepared for this. He turns around and he tries to walk up to him like, "Are you all right?" And Mr. Crowley turns around. His hand turns into a spike and impales the shit out of the other guy. And I'm just like, whoa, I didn't see that coming. Whoa. And then I sort of thought afterward, if this is Christopher Lloyd doing this, wouldn't it be great if he had a cartoon anvil underneath his fist or something like that? But in all seriousness, I got to preview this movie at Comic-Con last year when I was honored to sit at a panel with a press release and watch Christopher Lloyd come up and discuss his character in the film. Spoiler alert, he's not exactly human. But
He's a machine. No.
yes. The reasons for doing what he does it and what he is, it's more like you have to watch the movie and figure it out for yourself. But it's great watching him go back and forth with this kid. They know stuff about each other, and they know that they can't approach each other in public with it. Otherwise, they're both going to get in trouble. But Max, even though he's technically a sociopath, is bending the law to do everything he can to stop this guy from killing again. Now, there are some creature effects that I got to preview also at the Comic-Con.
Right.
I am proud to say they specifically said a lot of things. They wanted to do film because they liked the look of film.
Right.
And they knew that they had a low budget working with this.
Mm-hmm.
So they couldn't do CGI.
Right.
What did they do? They use a rod puppet for the creature. It's probably about, I don't know, it looked like in the footage I saw it was about 2 to 3 feet tall.
Yeah.
And there's a bunch of guys in green suits operating it.
Okay.
And I'm looking at this footage and I'm saying, I wonder how this is going to look in the final. It's pretty much Monster Maker from what I'm looking at.
Okay.
And then I see it in the final product. And I'm proud to say this would make the guys who did Alien very proud.
Oh.
This creature, it is composited very well. It looks like it's within the film's atmosphere. I think that it was overall a very well produced, directed, independent horror thriller, and I highly suggest you guys see it. It's on Netflix. Check it out.
Okay.
Speaking, 2016 has been like juicing out like all these 80s throwbacks. It's unbelievable. My Independent was a kind of like a slice of life slash romantic movie called Sing Street. Sing Street is a independent movie where it's set in the 80s in Dublin, Ireland. It shows about a boy going through school and all that stuff. He meets a girl, gorgeous girl, falls in love, sort of gets a crush on her. Figures the best way to break the ice with her is say, hey, I'm in a band. So he says that, and he actually creates a band and starts to like play music and feature in the music videos they make. They start romancing. It's just a nice little story, you know, nice little story. You see how the band comes together. You see how they make the music. Oh my God, the songs they make and the music. And the movie is like unbelievable. It sounds like the 80s, actually, in a way. There's one that you can view on YouTube. It's
Drive It Like You Stole It.
Thank you. Drive It Like You Stole It. That's like the main one they do at a senior prom. They do that one. It's really great music. They also make a lot of reference to the 80s. The band is called Sing Street, which is why the movie's called Sing Street for some reason. They explain it in the movie. They make a lot of references to the 80s. They reference how they're watching like MTV on TV, and they show Duran Duran's Rio, which I showed James last night, which he wasn't a big fan of Rio, but it's okay. It's just dripping with 80s as well, and it just, a lot of people liked it, and it might be a contender in the Oscars, maybe. Who knows? Because it's a nice...
Why am I dripping with 80s?
Dripping with 80s. It's seriously, if you just want to see a decent 80s throwback, go see Sing Street. It's actually on Netflix as well right now. So just look it up and enjoy the trip of a boy who wants to meet a girl by being in a band.
Inspired by Hall & Oates, apparently.
Isn't that the plot to Rock of Ages?
No.
Except better done.
Don't even.
I like Mike's reaction better. No. Like, that doesn't exist.
I have a relationship with that movie, so don't even go there.
No.
No.
All right.
What?
You're wrong.
Your turn.
Oh, yeah, your turn.
What is your laughably bad movie, Morgan?
Oh, you didn't do an independent?
He did an independent. It was The Shallows.
Yeah, it was
earlier. Oh, duh.
Let's see. This is making it quicker for us. All right, so Laughably Bad, which is a movie that is so bad it's laughable.
Let me tell you, Norm of the North didn't tickle me in any way. It just kind of sat there and was like, eh, whatever. Gods of Egypt didn't finish. Batman vs. Superman, that was more annoying than actually funny. So I'm probably going to have to go with one that I saw in theaters and I couldn't believe it existed.
Mm-hmm.
It's, as an adaptation, it fails on every level. Every time I think about it, I can't help but laugh my ass off when it comes to how they could mismanage Alice Through the Looking Glass.
Okay. All right.
We tied!
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. Should I let you go first?
Oh, boy.
You had a more interesting reaction than I did. I sat back going, hey, they went this far. How could they go this far? It's ridiculous.
You ever sit back and wonder how this could possibly be made after the reaction to the 2010 Alice in Wonderland? I guess the box office came in, and what they said to themselves is, well, we need to make a sequel, but a lot of people didn't like what they did there in terms of the tone. So what we gotta do is make it a lot lighter and frothier and take all the war and the bad stuff and the conflict out. Well, they didn't take it all out, otherwise it would be completely bland. But yeah, what we get is lighter, frothier, and surprisingly low on everything. The visuals, of course, are great. Most of the time, a lot of it was very obvious green screen. Very obvious green screen shots.
Way too obvious.
When you have actors acting that stale, like they're not invested in their universe. Even Sacha Baron Cohen, but just sort of felt like, hey, I'm on the green screen. I'm on a trolley track on a green screen.
I'll get you, but I'll be pissed. Stop.
It's all so fake. I sat back and rewatched Narnia recently, and that holds up better than this. But yeah, with this one, you ever ask yourself questions like how the Red Queen's head got so big? Because I sure didn't. But this movie has to explain that. We're going back and forth in time, trying to figure out whose problems need what kind of fixing. And every time they go back in time and fix something, they screwed something else up, so they got to go back and fix that. And it's unbelievably low on conflict for what even that is worth. There's no sense of interest. At least I can say with Alice in Wonderland, there was something interesting about that. This was just a clusterfuck. I mean, does everyone need a happy ending? I don't think so. Not this cast. Does it really resolve everything? Yes, but maybe some things were not meant to be resolved. It just doesn't. It's trying to correct the mistakes that they thought the previous film had, but it's making it worse in the process. And that's why we both find this laughably bad.
I mean, even then, I grew up reading the book, even I Was Looking Glass, and I found it interesting how they took an allegory for chess and turned into a fantasy adventure. That is a much more interesting idea. And they've done that as two TV movies. One in 1966 with Jack Palance as the Jabberwock, which, by the way, I gotta show Matt at some point. I think he'll like that more than this one, but even then I think that version will make him like this one a little more. And then there's the 1980s one with Ringo Starr's The Mock Turtle, and that's the only reason I remember those movies, actually.
Irwin Allen Productions.
Oh, yeah, and what's her name as the White Queen? Not...
Anne Hathaway.
Carol Channing! Carol Channing!
Oh,
Carol Channing.
Oh, that...
That
oh,
one. Jam Irwin tomorrow, Allen. Jam today!
I feel better.
God almighty. Why can we have that one? That one had a better story. That one had a better arc.
Because...
Damn it, making me think of that scene. Even that had a better character arc, because he had Alice growing up and all that such. This one... Okay, we did kind of the chess thing in the first movie, so what do we got? I know, let's make a time travel story, because those are popular. That's not what Alice in Wonderland or Alice in the Living Class was about. It was going into this whole strange world and seeing it through the perspective of her point of view, because she's the straight person in this whole thing. Just new, normal, everything else around her is just weird and bizarre, and we have to relate to her for those reasons. This film is so odd that when they have a whole new explanation for something on top of it, it gets... Because when you really do think about it, everything would have been just fine if Alice didn't interfere with time. And even before then, when we find out the main reason why the Red Queen is who she is, it's such a ridiculous excuse that when you consider that so many wars have been fought, so many people have died, so many things happened, all because the White Queen did not admit that she stole a cookie as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is that the only thing you can come up with? And then we have the Mad Hatter, who's barely in it at all, is this whispery Sylvester voice, not even that insane or crazy or interesting. All the side characters are there for paycheck. Anne Hathaway is just doing this the entire time. Just this. You must go into time and stuff. The only thing interesting is sadly what they throw in, which is Sacha Baron Cohen as time. And he's like a lost Flash Gordon villain, has no idea what he's doing.
It was time. Time, I don't even think, was an element in the stories.
No, it wasn't. Maybe in a poem, that's all I remember. And I feel bad because he's the only entertaining thing. And it's a testament to Cohen's work. When he's doing a character, he'll give his 110%. Pirelli and Sweeney Todd, Master of the House, Les Miserables. Mm-hmm. When he's doing a character for someone else, he'll really go all out and make this character. And he'll really make it fun and interesting. When he's doing his own material, like the Brother Grimsby, it's miserable.
That was him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Spoiler alert, he ends up in the vagina of an elephant during mating season.
Pass.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's the elephant scene in a nutshell. That's why I refuse to see Grimsby, because that's the one scene they're promoting. But moving on.
And then, so long as Ace Ventura crawls out the other end, I'm fine.
They kind of sort of do that at one point. I saw the scene. I didn't see the movie. I only saw the scene. There's a point where he sticks his head out, and this male elephant comes by and goes, "Oh, get back inside!"
Oh. Okay, but,
I'll leave it at that, because I don't want YouTube to flag us for pornographic material. It's elephants mating! Come on!
Time... I remember going to that once, into that one part, where we were like, we see where time lives, and he goes into this one room where there's all these clocks hanging down, and I'm just like they're ripping off All Dogs Go to Heaven here.
And especially,
it's like, oh, this is your watch, Charlie. It stopped.
I like the fact that death exists in this universe. There's a scene where he closes a stopwatch and it just cuts away this guy eating soup, and he just falls face first into a dead. And there's this mancer who's a frog who just looks by him going, "Ooh."
Mm-hmm. And he did that because, yep. Yeah, that's pretty much all we had to see that over that one. Except, should I tell them?
Yeah.
What we did? Yeah, we decided to go ahead and record our reactions to this one, and it's going to be another Jaime Tude and Morgan watches like we did with the Nutcracker several years ago.
It won't be painful, but it will be interesting.
Yeah. It's a very different kind of experience, so expect that at some point this year. All right, Mike. You're laughing bad.
What? What's going on? Oh, I'm sorry.
There's a test.
What test? So my laughably bad, like I said, 2016 was oozing out with the 80s, and another sequel came out this year, and it features characters from a certain TV show that appears in this movie for the first time. Finally, after all these years.
Was it Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
Yes, it was. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
I knew anything. If someone had to bring that up, it was gonna be you, Mike.
Out of the Shadows, DMNT, Out of the Shadows was my lively bad. Like, this is way better than the first film. My God.
Oh! Excuse me while I check my dick size while you're talking about this.
Oh! Come on.
Oh,
my man.
Peep Up and Rocksteady were the best thing about this. The chemistry between them two are amazing. That's why it's so laughably bad. It's like, really, dick sizes? But hey, they have great chemistry, though. I mean, you don't see Shredder as often because he's just put away, because Krang's like the main one. He's like, I'm here. And then Brad Garrett voices Krang for some odd reason. I don't know why. That's horrible. You could have got somebody else to voice him. I mean, I think they had somebody else at one point, and then he got replaced. And I was like, really? Really, people? But the Turtles have a lot more action. The action between Bebop and Rocksteady and the Turtles is just like the only action scene that there is with them is in, like, in Brazil at the airplane scene. It's just, and then Casey Jones, for lack of what it is, he's okay at most, but it's way better than the first movie, people. It's, I enjoyed it for what it was. I swear. Let me check.
Keep going. Sorry, yeah, I should not get you off. Go on. You forgot to talk about that mutagen that turns them human. They go absolutely nowhere with it. Here, you have the choice, Raph. Rah, we waste a blood red for nothing.
Because we owe a family of turtles. I don't know. It's, that subplot would have been interesting to see if they were humans or not, but, I mean, I just enjoyed it for what it was, and I laughed every Bebop and Rocksteady at the most of it.
That, okay, I will give you that. Bebop and Rocksteady had some moments. I thought the one line that I remember where I think that one actor who was playing Bebop, The guy who who's in the new Gary Who's Line. Gary
Williams. Yeah, Gary Williams, yeah.
Funny guy.
Yeah, they have... Yeah, he's enjoying himself, you know, before the transformation, before he becomes a warthog.
Yeah. Fuck. A piggy thing.
He has that one introduction when they're in the truck and he's opening up the door. He's like, "Hey, how you doing? My name's Bebop." He kicks, and he kicks the driver unconscious. And I was like, "Okay, that was corny and over the top and funny."
Can I just ask, Tyler Perry as Baxter Stockman?
He is so goofily. He's so goofy. He is. He's got the biggest grin on the face in the world. He's having a time of his life in this movie.
Wouldn't it be funnier if he drank the formula and turned into Eddie Murphy for a split second?
Oh, yes. Yes, that would have made. That would improve the film by. Nothing.
Ooh, I'm thin and funny! I'm thin and funny! I'm thin and funny!
And then he turns into a fly. They had a missed opportunity to do that from the original show. It's like, turn him into a fly.
There were so many missed opportunities with that movie.
There was,
at least there's less of Megan Fox. Casey Jones, the guy from Arrow,
Stephen Amell.
didn't do anything for me. He's trying to be imitating, but he just feels like he's channeling Ryan Reynolds from Deadpool too much, trying to be so cheery and stuff. He destroys a bar for interrogation.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, and he goes in the jukebox. He pulls out a Vanilla Ice CD. Ice Baby, I like this.
Should have been the fucking ninja rap. If you want to be that harsh, do the fucking ninja rap. That movie tries way too hard. And it's funny because we talked about Alice in Looking Glass. That film is trying to wreck the wrongs of the first film. And with Alice in Looking Glass. Yeah, exactly. I didn't like the first film for what it was doing. This one, they're trying to improve upon things, but it falls so short because it's trying to please the fans way too hard. The only thing that I find interesting is Will Arnett. Because after watching BoJack Horseman, I have more respect for him now than I ever did. Hell, maybe the Nut Job's actually funny. I've yet to see that one. But... Yeah, whatever. With Out of the Shadows, all the ingredients making a good Turtles movie was there.
Yeah, it just...
But nothing clicked together. The plot threads didn't go anywhere. The things they tossed in. The only thing that's kind of credible were the action scenes, but even they just feel so short of themselves.
I just feel like, yeah the action scenes alone, actually, because the Foot Clan are actually freaking Foot Clan ninjas for once. They have... There's a scene where they're... the turtles are in their dumpster truck van and they're shooting the covers and it's like, oh my gosh. And then they had the explosion where the Foot Clan was on top of the truck trying to get Shredder out, and it's like, ah, it's so amazing.
I felt I just got partway through this movie. I used this as a dozer, and My impressions of it were everything that they're trying to get right here is counterbalanced by something that they're getting wrong. There's too many. The Bayisms are still in play.
I mean, this is from a different director. It's from Dan Green, who did Earth to Echo.
I don't care.
And I mean, this, sure, he's producing it, he's funding it, he's making sure the movie's going all right. I mean, you might see a little bit of Bayism in there, more or less, but it's like the 80s cartoon. If you want to see a live-action cartoon, this is what I enjoyed about it. It's like, it's cartoony as hell, and it tries
Bebop to be... Bebop and Rocksteady checked out their dicks in the 80s? I don't think so.
No.
Okay.
Did Bebop and Rocksteady ever expel gas when Shredder was trying to steal a diamond or something? Just for no reason. Hurry. Here's my own version. Here's my own version of the Big Bang.
No, but they left at Stinky Socks in one episode. I
Yeah.
I remember.
Yeah.
I'll
So.
give the film a little bit of this much. In terms of scientifically trying to explain the connection between the ooze and our animal ancestors, it sounded stupid, but remember, it sounded stupid and it is stupid, but at the same time, you have to remember, we're very genetically related to pigs. Our DNA. So there's or something like that, but I at least they were trying to explain that connection. I don't know, with the cartoon, they explained it by saying it's that turns you into whatever ooze turns you into whatever animal you're more affinity with. And so there you just saw them being shipped off with a rhino and a warthog, and they just said, "Okay, let's make something of this." Then maybe the movie was trying to explain it a little bit better, but
Yeah, that part, yeah, I do agree. That part was kind of like, because the turtles, they were turtles before, and then the ooze got them, and they become humanoid, and I guess the other way around, just didn't, they couldn't bring like rhinos in or something like that. I mean, to think of it like this, like if it was like with us, like James would be an otter, he'd be mutated into an otter, Morgan would be mutated into a fox, I'd be mutated into a wolf, so that's what the logic is.
I don't know, I
are you
might also
saying?
be part gorilla.
Morgan, what's your best?
Should we do best first or should we do worst?
I mean, James and I already did our best already, so just get your best out of the way, and then we can just end off with the worst.
All right. It's surprising because this one was already talked about earlier, so I'm the only person talking about this. I'll try to make this a little different. There's only one movie that I said was the best of the entire year and is criminally underrated. It's no surprise, it's Kubo and the Two Strings. And it's funny because it was going to go to Zootopia, but here's how I see it. Zootopia is the best animated film of last year. In terms of best film overall, it's Kubo and the Two Strings. You have a kid character that's going through this huge journey, and there's so much baggage going on here. Family problems, separation, all these things. And the journey that he partakes is so surrealistic, but just so interesting. And the fact that he's pitted in these, different perils, like a giant samurai skeleton, underwater field of eyes and stuff, that you kind of wonder just how he's able to go through all this sort of thing. And there's such a really good message at the end that it shows the power of storytelling and how it can identify and define a person, or give someone a sense of identity. There's such a majesty and beauty to this movie, animation-wise, that I still question why it didn't do so well at the box office. Was it bad release timing? Was it because like it's not having a good streak? It's still mind-boggling to me. I still don't understand it. It had great reviews. It's still getting a huge following, even as we speak. I really, really hope this wins an Oscar at the Academy Awards, even though I know it won't. At least get something at the Annie Awards. This is truly such a This film really took my breath away. There's so much emotion riding on it. You have the monkey character and the beetle accompanying him that are almost like a father, mother, yin yang kind of ability. And there's a lot of great action scenes. There's one where the monkey is fighting one of the witch sisters, and it's very brutal and very intense. It's on a boat of leaves. There's so much strangeness and creativity that you kind of wonder just how Laika is able to take this very bizarre tale and make it so engaging and heartwarming and unique and very engaging. And the three-dimensional characters and what they go through and why?
It's
Why?
mind-numbing, like I said earlier, why this didn't
Why?
do better.
I mean,
I'm gonna have to absolve my guilt now by actually renting it through our library system.
I mean, I saw this movie in theaters a month after, and I'm glad I saw it in theaters. There was a little bit of an audience, at least. But at the same time, it's like, man, this is so well polished.
It's perplexing actually, because we talked about it when we all watched it together, and it just for the second time or third time or first time, it was just
I can
I was
relate.
looking at the numbers and their budget was the same, but just like the box office results, just like really people, nobody went to see this. It's like what the heck did you guys do over the summer? Like what
Stupid!
did you
You're
guys?
so
I mean,
stupid!
it was up against Pete's Dragon that was going out for the second week at that time, and then you had War Dogs and Ben-Hur that weekend. So what did you guys go see then, besides Pete's Dragon? Did you guys go see War Dogs or Ben-Hur? No.
No.
They probably stayed home and watched the presidential debates.
Or they could be there, they could have been
I
at
was
home.
working.
But yeah, Kubo and the
I remember
T-Strings.
what I was doing during those. I was working.
Was a joke.
I know.
Kubo, yeah, like the animation is just it's stellar, and the story, the voice acting is good in it too. There's like great performances from like Charlize Theron and Matthew McConaughey. Like this is his first animated feature. It's really good acting from Matthew McConaughey. Then you got the Rooney Mara doing the sisters. She does. The sisters alone are creepy enough to give you nightmares a little bit. I mean, maybe it could be a next Halloween costume.
I actually concur with that. I actually found a more creepiness with the Moon King played by Ralph Fiennes. And that's because there's so much buildup to his character. And
Oh,
they keep talking
yeah.
about him in the first half. And when we see him for the first time in Kubo's dream, he's very calm, very serene. There's something so eerie about it. And then when we see him in the final confrontation, we see him for what he truly is. He's bigoted of the human race. He doesn't see the true emotion for what they really are. They're just ants, and to him, he's just their god. And I don't want to give away the ending, but they do something really, really clever at the end, which you don't see a lot with today's animated movies, which I kind of, in a sense, wish they did more of, with the demise of the villain. It doesn't end in death. It's something a little different, and I actually really applaud them for it. It literally makes me go to tears every time I see it. It's the new Bing Bong for me. Just that moment where he goes, "Oh, Kubo, I'm so sorry." Like, no, he's not just apologizing because of, what he's missed out, but just how he's so wrong. It is such a really perfect, very emotional scene, and there's such a beauty to it, especially when the villagers get in. It's morons, all of you, morons!
You can still.
I haven't seen a villain. I haven't seen a villain ending rewriting this way since Warriors of Virtue.
To translate in Fizgig terms.
Yes. You can
Yes.
still support it, people. You can buy it on DVD and Blu-ray. Just support it. Have it
Please.
in your collection. Get those
Please.
sales up for home media, because that'll tell people, hey, this movie's great and deserves a lot more than it should.
And I'm sure if Matt was here, he'd say that Norm in the North is the best movie of last year.
Oh no, we already have him pegged for that for the worst. We know that. We don't even have to ask him. He's not here. We'll just say, Matt, would you tell us what the worst is? I think it's going to be Norm of the North. You know what? I spent these last several nights watching that movie so I could discuss it with you, but you're not here.
I can discuss it with you because I saw the movie.
Exactly, you two discuss it, because I still haven't seen it. Thank goodness.
No, I'd say Matt probably thinks Deadpool is the worst of
He still
2016.
hasn't seen the damn movie.
Hell, he thinks Ghostbusters is the worst thing going. He hasn't even seen it. Send him hate mail. Send him hate mail.
Okay.
He's gonna kill me after this. But all right.
Okay. Am
Worst of
I?
the year.
The worst. Yes, we're up to the worst, the grand finale of this episode. So, what is the worst?
I like to go last.
Okay.
Trust me. I'd like to go last.
All right. Hopefully we don't okay. tie.
Okay. I have such a rant for this one, but go on.
All right.
Okay. My worst. Batman versus Superman.
Yeah, I was expecting that.
Even worse than the Killing Joke. Yeah, it's still that bad. But here's the kind of bad it is. It's the fact that the version that I saw was one that you, Morgan, edited down to try and make it less stupid.
Oh, and we'll yet, tell that. We'll tell that story in a second. But go on.
And yet, it still managed to suck the soul out of me. That's just saying. I'm looking at the tips of my fingers because I'm gonna shoot something.
I'm looking at James. He's above me.
Oh.
He's I would
so
say.
High above me. Sorry, go on.
The fact that you alone tried to edit it to make it less stupid, and yet it still was painful to look at, that is a testament to just how bad this is. You have, I think we discussed a lot of this during the Batman episode.
Yes, yeah.
Or did we have a Batman episode?
Yeah, we did. I think we mentioned it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with David Rose, yeah, we did that.
Oh yeah, for a little bit. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, we were talking with him about it, and
yeah, a little bit. Yeah, I remember that. I think you guys had a small talk about that. Yeah.
Everyone. Everything about this, in terms of just the way Batman's character was treated, I was disappointed.
What?
I mean,
you were disappointed with Batman? He's the best thing. He's the best thing apart the most.
He makes me nostalgic for Daredevil.
Are you kidding me? Ben Affleck was the best part of. Everybody's like, hey, he's the best part of it. He's a great Batman. He's a great Bruce Wayne.
No, he's terrible. And I'll tell you why. Because I didn't see everyone coming out with that judgment. What I see here is a Batman who has lost faith in humanity, which is everything against his character. He is someone who hit bottom and had to scrounge his way up. Not financially, mind you. He's a character who's lost. No.
Let him have the mic. Let him have the mic, Mike.
No, he does stuff that Batman does not do. He does not just go out and fight crime and get pissed off and kill people because that's what superheroes do, right? No, he feels like he does it because he feels like his city is worth saving. And the reason why he blames Superman for everything, just because he's got superpowers and he had to save some people that he couldn't save in the beginning of the film. It does not add up. Why did these characters hate each other? It just does not mesh. It does not mesh. I don't care how glowy your eyes are. You look like Lego freaking Batman. You didn't even check out. You didn't even audition for this role. You got it as a deal. Oh, man. I had to let that out. I play Arkham Knight and the Arkham games. I love them to death. This is and so Superman dies. Spoiler alert. And at the movie ends with him saying, you know what, I think we should form a team. And it just sort of comes out of this saying, we need an Avengers. We need an Avengers in the DC universe. That'll save us. And that's coming up. And yeah. I think Zack Snyder, whatever he's worth now, his days are his his days directing good movies, I think they're past. I think he should be replaced. I hate to say it because I loved Owls of Ghul. I like 300. I like those movies. Watchmen was a good one too. That Dawn of the Freaking Dead was awesome as a remake. But no, what's happening here? It's not clicking. Superman, he's just boring. He just sort of happens. Lex Jr.
Or Lex Luthor.
Yeah, Eisen Luthor. What is the deal with that guy? His reasoning for going against Superman equates that he should not exist because he has the powers of a god and a man cannot do that. Bullshit. This is a superhero. This is a superhero universe. Amazing things happen. You can't have the powers of the god if you're a human being, but you can use your own DNA to create frickin' Doomsday. How does that add up? He's not charming. He's dicking around with Jolly Ranchers. His voice is nasal and annoying, and I hope Rio 3 is really good.
Wait, he's in that one?
I don't know if that's in the works, but man, I will line up for Rio 3 after this. I don't care how bad it is. So,
yeah,
that's my rant.
I should probably explain to the viewers, when the 3-hour cut came out, I was so bored with it that I started realizing, oh, wait, I can do my own version. So I plopped it into some editing software. As I started cutting it, I realized, that's a waste of time, that's a waste of time, that's a waste of time, that's a waste of time. And I made so many trims. It went from 3 hours, to I think like 2 hours and 9 minutes or 2 hours and 2 minutes. I was perplexed. I was like, I think I made a better movie here, even though there's still some stupid stuff. So I showed that version to James. It's a Cliff Notes abridged version, and I don't know if I'm glad or regret it, but in my view, I think I made a better movie by pace, but not a better movie by story.
There's no fixing it.
No,
it's okay. You had your chance.
I tried.
You had your expert. I'm not bashing that.
Because
hug.
It's okay. Because once we get to the Doomsday stuff, that wasn't until like maybe an hour and 20 minutes in, or an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm.
And even then, there was some crucial stuff I did cut out because it was stupid. When he shoves Zod into the gene pool, what I nixed off was the bit where the computer was like, oh, this is unlawful to do because it goes against Kryptonian law, and then God damn it. Lenny Luthor is all like, where are all the Kryptonians? Dead. Okay, I'll do it for you. Then starts to make the Doomsday creature hybrid or whatever. This movie is just annoying to me. I remember seeing that movie on Easter weekend. Easter weekend of all days! And I didn't show this in that version either. The Jesus symbolism is so heavy. When we see Superman's body, there's like 3 crosses in the background. It's nuts. Henry Cavill, not that interesting, even though he's trying. I don't know what it is. This one and Man of Steel are so glum and grim. Make these movies fun and interesting. That's why I preferred Civil War over this one, because at least with Civil War, there was flair and interest. Batman vs. Superman, there's so much ideology, I want to vomit a Bible. Rick James style. It was that bad. Granted, there was worse movies, but this film was already deemed worse the minute it came out, so I'm not going to beat around the bush.
Mike, your defense.
Martha!
Why'd you say that you name?
Martha's my brother!
No, I was just trying to be the audience goer that says, Batman's the... It was really good in that movie. Ben Affleck did a great job.
Martha!
But
they're gonna kill Martha!
Yeah, Zack Snyder is becoming a really bad director, and he needs to stop what he's doing and refresh his mind. Get somebody else to do Justice League, for crying out loud.
By the way, was Sucker Punch any good?
I haven't seen that one yet.
Neither have
I. I'd rather watch that again.
Which one? The extended version or the theatrical?
The theatrical.
Okay.
I mean, it was dumb, but it was kind of enjoyably dumb.
I could probably cut out all the psychopathic stuff, so everything that happens is all real and... forget. Mm-hmm. You can't even save that one. It's like, it's reality, but it's a dream within a dream within a dream while she's being lobotomized. Like, Purcell did that better, for goddamn sake.
But yeah, the DC movies are trying to be dark and gritty compared to the Marvel films, who are fun and delightful and have these great characters, and DC's just going down this dark and gritty route. They're not going to be fun. I mean, Suicide Squad tried to be fun at least at some point, because they're like, oh shit, Batman v Superman did not do good. We have to reshoot. We have to make this more fun. We can't be dark and gritty because it's not working. So... this year, hopefully, Wonder Woman does a great thing for DC, and then Justice League has something for DC. I mean, this might be their chance to redeem themselves, hopefully.
You know what? Wonder Woman deserves a good movie. I'm just throwing that out there.
And I think this year Wonder Woman would be great, because it's not directed by Zack Snyder, thank God. It's by some female director, so it's got promise. Trailers are looking great. Gal Gadot playing Wonder Woman, she's doing a good part with it, so fingers crossed.
Even though her implementation, her introduction in this film was kind of weird, to say the least. But
the DC is trying to catch up with Marvel. It's all they're doing. They're just kind of late to the game.
Take your time. Take your time. Marvel had to get its footing.
The director in question you're thinking, Mike, is Patty Jenkins.
Yeah, that's what I said. A female director.
She did Monster.
Yeah, there was, I mean, it's something different besides Zack fucking Snyder. So, hopefully with my worst, I do not tie with Morgan. Or if we do tie, we could talk about it together, because I know this worst.
No, you're not going to tie. You're not going to tie. Mine is worse than yours.
You sure? I know we're going to tie.
No. Mine's Johnny Depp free. You don't have to worry. No, I found a worse movie than that one.
You son of a bitch. Yeah, so...
I found a worse movie than that
so,
one, but go on.
So last year I said Scout's Guide to Zombie Apocalypse was worse for a comedy. Now another comedy this year. Call it a comedy. I also got my worst. And it's by Kevin Smith. And also, hello, I'm here for your daughters. Because...
Bobcat?
Because the daughters of Kevin Smith and Johnny Depp are not good actors and yoga hosers.
Yeah, you ever wonder where that view askew charm went with Kevin Smith's films?
This is a new set of movies that started off with Tusk.
I know.
But, okay. This wasn't funny. This wasn't funny. Like I said, the acting from Harley Quinn Smith and Lydia Lydia Depp, I believe is her name, Rose. They don't act. They're not. They're just such, oh, millennial teens. These teens. Oh my God. These. I just want to. And then the Nazi part of it. The Nazi brats. The Nazi.
The Bratzies.
Bratzies. I just. There's that the seat the special effects are horrible. Kevin Smith is playing the Bratzies. They're supposed to be stuffed with sour cream. They look like macaroni and cheese. It's just it's. And then
It's on Netflix.
yes, that's how I saw it. It's on Netflix for crying out loud. And then you have because he was in Tusk apparently. You have Haley Joel Osment playing a bit part. As you know, backstory of about the Canadian Nazis, and the villain of the movie is just horrible. There's a scene in the movie where they're talking to each other, and he starts using different voices because he didn't want to use his German Nazi accent. So he's doing impressions of other celebrities, and it's just, what are you doing, movie? Kevin Smith, what are you? Are you high? Did you write this as you were high or something? What is this movie? It's like, oh sure, I'll just cast my daughter in this. She'll be an actress after this. Sure, I mean.
She probably got this role as a birthday present from daddy.
Along with the Harley Quinn bat, yeah, sure, because that's her fucking name for crying out loud. The teenage girls are so and then oh I forgot about this part. Justin Long is in this too, playing teaming up with Kevin Smith after Tusk, and then he's playing
No, wait,
this.
Justin Long, that's who I was thinking of in Skylanders Academy, not Jason Lee.
Why are you thinking Jason Lee?
I don't know. Mixing up my Kevin Smith actors. Go on.
Yes, you are. Yes, Justin Long plays this. Justin Long plays this yoga master that teaches these teens the their yoga.
I can't be named Boo Boo? What do you mean it's copyrighted?
There's a that's a side that's like a running gag with him because his yoga place is called Yogi Bear Yoga thing. It's like related to Yogi Bear, and it's like they trying to get copyright from like. Copyrights because he can't use that name, and then after the things happened, he wanted to add Boo Boo because some odd reason, and then it's like, what? How come? It's like, nah, I came out with it on my own. It's like, really, the copyright is. Kevin
You
Smith,
forgot you forgot Johnny Depp.
Johnny Depp, he wasn't in that. I mean, he's got makeup on, prosthetics. He's got the nose and the funny accent, but I mean, he's nothing to swat a fly at. He was just a little bit smidge of the movie. Everything else was just the elements of, I mean.
You know,
I mean,
there's a reason.
wait, before you go on,
Sorry.
at least I'm excited for Kevin Smith's next movie. It has more promise than this fucking movie. His next movie is basically called Jaws Moose, which is Jaws with a moose. And hopefully Kevin Smith does not feature the girls in the movie that much because they're fucking annoying.
Oh, they were in
I know
Tusk, and
I know
that turned out garbage.
Mr. Mustache.
I know they were in Tusk. They were short a little bit, but that's why there's a spin-off because this is why they just give them their own fucking movie.
Moose Jaws. No, he.
I mean.
I didn't even see Yoga Hosers. Two people coming through and hating on it. Is enough. And I look at this and I say, okay, Moose Jaws. It's Jaws with a moose. Is
Jansel
there?
and Bob are going to be in it.
Exactly.
And Son
I
of
don't
Bob's going
care.
to get And Silent Bob's gonna get eaten by the moose.
Exactly.
Well, I can't say that that really raises my hopes for it. My deal is, like I said before, at least the view askew years had their charm to it. Whatever is happening, Tusk and onward, I thank you, Morgan, for sending me Tusk. I still remember watching that after you wrote up a report on it, a review and everything, and before I watched that, you'd sent me the copy, and I said, "So, would you like to rewatch that tonight?" And you were just like, you sent me back a text going, "No, no, 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 you're on your own."
That got horrifying really fast.
Yeah, and so Yoga Hosers, I have no will to see, and I'm not seeing Moose Jaws.
You're not missing much with Yoga Hosers. Thinking about it now, I kind of see why Kevin Smith made that movie. He made it as a response to the critics who hated Tusk. In the climax, the German guy reveals he made this monster out of human skin, and for no reason it has Jason's hockey mask on it. He's all like, "Oh, I made wonderful art, but critics hated it, so now I have something big and amazing here, and I'm gonna take over the world and stuff."
Oh, shit, that's right. How did I forget about that?
The dumbest part of the movie, and you forgot about it?
Because it's Kevin Smith's giant middle finger to
the critics. Yes.
And if you're going to do that, do it smart. Do it right. There's movies that can do that. One Crazy Summer had Siskel and Ebert as bunnies getting blown up. Do things like that. Come on.
Yeah, Kevin, you can do better than that, for crying out loud. Jesus Christ, you did great movies back in the day. I know you're not 20. You're not in your 20s anymore, but Jesus Christ, it's like Clerks and freaking Giant Slime Bob Strikes Back. I mean, and then Chasing Amy is like, what the hell happened to you? I mean, you're doing Mallrats 2 eventually. I know that.
I have a movie that trumps all that, and I tried getting a copy to prove it to you guys, but only one available is a camera recording. So much for that. This is a movie it's made by a guy I never want to spotlight or talk about because it's not worth it. But unfortunately, I paid to see it. Now I gotta explain it. So, worst movie of the year for me was Boo, a Medea Halloween.
I was gonna go there.
You know, Tyler Perry is interesting. He's donated to charities. He's a good actor. He was in Gone Girl. He's a nice guy in interviews and such. Unless you cross him or say negative things about his work, see his argument with Spike Jonze. I don't want to talk about that battle. It's something entirely different. If you make fun of him, he gets cross. That's happened before. He's lent off a good bulk of his movie studio lot to The Walking Dead at one point, just out of generosity. Alright. So explain to me why he's not made a good movie. I don't even know how to answer that question. It's boggled my mind ever since. His comedies feel like drama, and his dramas feel like unintentional comedies. Good Deeds, Single Wives Clubs. Ugh. And then you have his Medea movies, which he's been doing for a long time. And yet, nothing feels changed. It's like there's a formula to them. Something's going on, there's a big family issue. Medea comes in, does her crazy pistol packing stuff and her wacky antics. She does mean-spirited stuff to people. Then there's that moment where she says something meaningful about love, peace, whatever. And then in the last 10 to like 15 minutes, she goes against that completely. That's been constantly in a good bulk of those movies. And I've seen a lot of them to know that. Medea Goes to Jail, Witness Protection, Big Happy Family, Family Reunion. It gets so repetitive, it turns into a drinking game. And I feel bad because I don't want to knock down Tyler Perry because as a kid, he went through abuse. He went through a lot of things. He had a hard time getting work, and he became... he did, like, stage work and wrote plays. Those became popular. Those got turned to movies. That's where the Medea character came from on the stage. Alright, fine. Family influence. And I can see where that is in one of the pinnacle pieces of not just one scene, but the whole movie, which is supposed to be about parenting. Yeah, it's not about Halloween, it's not about saving the town, it's about parenting. It's talking about parenting. Bad parenting. How we should lecture our kids and be good parents. The main character of the movie is Brian, a character that Tyler Perry plays. Oh yeah, he plays a lot of his characters in this one. Apparently his daughter's being rebellious, wants to go to this party with these frat kids. And so he calls over Medea to babysit because he has this important meeting. Just says important meeting, doesn't say what's so important about it. Medea comes over with her brother and two other people just to be obnoxious and stuff. And that goes into like a 10 to 15 minute sequence, which figuratively feels like 3 hours. Where they talk about, oh, as a kid we did all this stuff to you and blah, 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 blah. And there's this one long, prolonged bit where the brother mentions, where Medea's brother mentions that he dropped Brian off a roof as a kid or something like that as a form of punishment, and they went to the hospital, and apparently he fell on a, like an umbrella or something, and then it went up his ass, and they had to go to the hospital for it. I ask you, where is the funny in that? Where is the funny? You're trying to make child abuse as something funny, like corporal punishment. You can't make corporal punishment funny unless it's done in either an over-the-top manner or if there is a point to it, or unless there's a purpose to the character and what he or she has done. So then the Halloween aspect kicks in, and the kid, of course, sneaks out to the party. She claims that the house that they're looking over is haunted. They kind of sort of believe it and they're superstitious about it. They go to the party. The frat guys are there. The daughter is underage. And when the frat guys find out, they freak out because earlier they're like, you know, the stereotypical, like, yeah, bro, we're about the party and stuff. And then they find out this one girl's 17. It's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. She's 17. We're going to get in trouble. Like, yeah, you're going to spoon feed us right now and make these people so good and respectable? Really? Really? After all that, hey, you want to hang out with us? We got booze, blah, 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 when you don't even know any better? And then, for like no apparent reason, it turns into a haunted house movie where the frat guys decide to get revenge on Medea because Medea calls the cops to shut them down at one point for revenge of throwing them out when they're looking for the daughter. So then the frat kids like pull pranks on them and stuff. They dress up as zombies and everything. And happens for like 5 minutes. There's a guy running around in a clown costume screaming the haunted house. So then Medea's like, oh, we're gonna get back to those kids, blah, 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 blah. And then they get the father Brian to come home. They tell him you gotta man up, blah, 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 blah. Medea has a little preachy message, and then they have their big prank with the frat boys, which completely goes against them. As it turns out, Medea has a terrorist watch on her. One of the college kids is like weed and stuff, and they have all these cops come in, and they don't know that information until they pull off the prank. And then the cops are like, phew, we found weed in the campus. Oh, I know you, Medea. You're on a terror watch list. And then it turns into a whole Three Stooges ending where everyone runs off in different directions without the wah 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 wah. So, and then
Medea's on the terror watch list.
Yeah, because in the previous movie she did a bunch of stuff. She did a bunch of property damage and all sorts of things. It's in Medea Goes to Jail.
You know what? I've heard of bad movie making as a crime, but that's kind of that's kind of harsh, don't you think?
Harsh. If you want to talk about a subject like this, talk about it. Do a documentary. Do at least some kind of movie, but don't do it in a movie like this where you're just spoon-feeding it, watering it down, patching it as comedy when it's not even good comedy. The Medea character I always found to be very mean-spirited because of the exact reason I said. She's constantly mean throughout every single movie, has no constant care for humanity or anything. She has, like, a 30-second change of heart, and then she'll go completely back on what she said earlier. It's happened before in Medea's Big Happy Family where she's trying to get the family or whatever to realize what's really going on, and one of the characters has cancer or something, she dies, and then she says, oh, apparently one of the people was traumatized because they were affected by incest and stuff and blah, 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 because the uncle did some bad things to her. And it's like, okay, fine, you're doing that. No. Then the ending, she goes on the Jerry Springer show to prove that one of the family members or whatever is like the father of one of the characters or something like that. So she's doing this for her own means and just to get back at them or something like that. It is such a vicious cycle. And Tyler Perry has made these movies again and again and again with no change, no respect for understanding where he stands in this material. Nothing feels updated. Everything is so constant and repetitive that it makes me wonder exactly just why he keeps making these movies. Why?
Because black audiences need to be entertained. I hate to pin it down to that, but that's everything that you've pretty much mentioned and ranted about there. It's apparently what they deem black audiences like to see.
There's better stuff. There is better stuff. Chris Rock did a movie called Top 5, showing Hollywood from the African-American point of view. There's another one that satirizes it called Hollywood Shuffle that has a really good Siskel and Ebert parody. Really watch it. I don't get it. You've done so many films. You have your own studio. And it feels like nothing's been changed. Nothing's changed. You go from playwriting to movie making, and nothing is altered. Everything is so constant and repetitive. Nothing feels learned outside of special effects, lighting, and maybe filmmaking, but in terms of script writing, he still hasn't improved. And I'm gonna break my pinky if I keep doing that, so I'm going to stop and say that is the
worst
thing
of all
time.
Switch to your ring finger.
No, that'll break off a little easier. I'm feeling it right now.
Okay.
It's hands down the worst movie of the year. It's legitimately the worst movie of the year.
What did you expect from a movie called Boo, a Madea Halloween?
Comedy!
At this rate?
I mean, people who go see... I mean, I understand the reviewers. These reviewers out there, I have to go see the movie, but it's just like, sometimes movies are not meant for certain people. So it's just, the comedy is not probably tailored to you. You know,
The only reason I went to see is because my mother wanted to, because she's a fan of her of his films.
Her so films.
His films, whatever. He dresses up as a woman. So, out of the kindness of my heart, I bit the bullet and said, do you still want to see this? So I figured, you know, fine, might as well. She was having a rough month. So I did it.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the thing. A lot of people have different tastes in movies. So I can understand your mother likes the Medea movies. I can understand that. She has a different taste in comedy, and, you know, a lot of people tick differently. So, yes, for you, that, I mean, it makes sense. I understand. It's just the comedy wasn't there. Medea's just... I don't know. I just never got into Medea. I don't know how these audiences like the comedy of Medea. So,
Supposedly, he's making another one on police brutality. Can you imagine that? Medea and police brutality? You can't make that funny! You're not this clever! Stop! It is time to stop! I can handle Ice Age 6, but this, no! No!
What is Medea gonna be going through there and be like, oh yeah, Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter! But you know what? Oh, you know they're gonna do that.
They're gonna. You know they're.
Except the Black Lives. I smack the black out of. Yeah, Black Lives Matter.
Jeez. I mean, at least he's being diverse in his work. He's done television work too. He's making shows for the Oprah Winfrey Network, and you know, so.
He's not talented enough. I mean, he can act. He can donate to charities. He'd be nice. He really needs to work on his storytelling.
See, he can act in other people's movies just fine, depending on the movie. But
Like Baxter Stockman.
When he does his own stuff, writing and directing and stuff, it just doesn't seem right. It's just weird. I mean, he was in the 2009 Star Trek movie for a brief role cameo thing, so that was weird, but it was like it was decent or whatever, but yeah. Fucking Tyler Perry.
I don't know. I got nothing. I think we need to call it a night.
I think 2016 has been a roller coaster ride, and we are in 2017, so hopefully this year, knock on wood, goes better, and a bunch of more movies.
We had good movies. We had good movies.
Yeah.
But
it's just
the ones that we talked about here, there's only so many categories for what. I mean, exactly. We could have gone and talked about Deadpool and a lot of other fun stuff.
Exactly.
It was a pretty good year for movies.
Yeah, it was.
For me, it was different. I thought the first third was fine. And then summer kicked around. And it really turned into a very slosh kind of year. Like, there were so many tentpoles left and right that just really weren't that good. They were either okay or just disappointing or underwhelming. Like, yeah, there was a few, Finding Dory and all that stuff, but no. And then the holiday kicked in and said, here you go. This is a good movie. This is for suffering through a lot of shit. To Sonya, thank!
Yeah, so... So next year we'll come back and review this year's crops of movies 2017. So there's plenty to go through, and we'll see you for that. But next time, we are going to talk about a certain actor, namely Dennis Quaid, since he's going to appear in A Dog's Purpose in a couple of weeks. So let's talk about his other work besides this upcoming movie he's decided to star in. I don't know who.
Don't make me see that one.
No, I'm not making you. You don't have to go see it unless you want to.
Make Matt see it, but for the love of God.
Like I said, I don't.
It's a stupid premise. It's a stupid premise.
Based on.
I like the way that it looks, honestly. I'll be interested in seeing what they do with it.
It's based on a book.
You have to consider the fact that the dog has to die every single time to start a new life cycle.
Yeah.
It's based around reincarnation.
The only way I want to see that is to see the kids in the audience get so confused. Like, oh, the dog is in the body of this dog, but now the dog has a new name, so is it the same dog in the new dog's body, or is it the same similar identity but just with a different name? Horrible premise.
You know what you remind me of right here by bringing this up? I was working in the schools one time. There was one of the college-age students. He had this fascination with the concept of reincarnation, and he was going on and over again. And one of the things that he said in his rambling, he was just like, you know, if there's anyone who deserves to be reincarnated, it's old Yeller. I mean, he was a good dog.
But he was the proud owner of rabies. God, I look like Gilbert Godfrey now.
The secret is out.
Oh, God.
You should share the rabies with the world.
It was interesting because Josh Gad gets to be the voice of the dog, but guess who was originally chosen for the role of the dog?
I know, Bradley
the Cooper.
That would have been something.
That would have been interesting just to have Rocky Raccoon voice the dog.
I still wouldn't have liked it, but it would have been at least an interesting performance.
But yes.
I'm Olaf. I have 5 different lives. Why couldn't they make Garfield and his line lives? At least that was an excuse for anthology. Oh yeah, it was an anime TV special. Not good enough! Come on! The graphic novel had 3 Stooges, the Vikings, the Primal Cat
Primal
one.
Self.
Yeah, Primal Self.
So yes, next
and
time...
And the TV series had him turn into a woman.
So yes, next time we're going to talk about Dennis Quaid. Probably the most underrated... Like you don't see him often in movies, but we'll talk about it in 2 weeks. So
I don't know. He was in the Day After Tomorrow.
We'll talk about that in 2 weeks. So thank you for watching this.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
I don't believe it. I simply don't.
Yes. So thank you for watching our very long premiere episode of season 5. Hopefully this season will be a great year for. Thanks for watching. Thank you and good night.
Ciao for now.
Go watch a good movie. I don't know anything else anymore. Extra Ball!